I feel like we're talking to a rocket scientist here. So we're very excited. Talithia, if you can come up and talk to us. Thanks.
Thanks, Todd. Hey, so I'm going to walk around because it's a breakfast talk. It's early. I know half of you are still sort of zoning out. The other half are on Facebook. But today we're going to talk about cultivating a STEM mindset. And so I want to engage in a conversation with you. I always like to give a little bit of background about sort of who I am and my upbringing, just so you can sort of see how that connects to the talk. I'm from Columbus, Georgia. Anybody from Georgia? The South? Alabama, North Carolina, South Carolina. Okay, Virginia, I'll go up. Maryland even, I'll count. Okay, all right. Midwest, Northeasterners here. I went to Spelman College. It's a historically black college for women in Atlanta, Georgia. So Spelman was the first place I went where I met African-American women with PhDs in mathematics in the math department. And so up until that point, I didn't really know that black women did math. I was decent in it in high school. It wasn't that I was super amazing at math. I mean, I wasn't super amazing at any subject necessarily, but this was sort of where I saw like, oh, really? Wow. This is me with Etta Faulkner. She was one of the first black women to get a PhD in mathematics in the United States. And so she was a great mentor for me and also a great example of what I could become. I went on to Howard University. I got a master's in math and then finished my PhD at Rice University. This is the day I graduated with some of my classmates and then our department chair, who was also my advisor, Kathy Enzer, is there in the back. So I had a great, just a great educational experience, both in a historically black college setting and then also in a setting where I was the only African-American and the only woman in my entering class. So very different in both of those situations, but still very supportive. As Todd mentioned, I spent 3 summers at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. Those were so amazing. First, it was my first time in Southern California, which was beautiful. I was in Dr. Lonnie Lane's research lab all 3 summers. The first time I met Lonnie, he introduces me to his team, and he goes, "Call me Lonnie." And I was like, I cannot form my mouth to call an adult by their first name. That's just how we were raised. Like, it was Mr., Dr., Reverend, Deacon, something had to come in front. And so I was just like, Dr. Lane. And he's like, "No, everybody, call me Lonnie. And I was like, And so I finally got used to calling him Lonnie. But what it did was it sort of invited me to the table, right? Because everybody at JPL was on a first name basis. So you didn't know who was the researcher, who was the administrator, who was the secretary. It was just that, you know, we're all here to contribute to a common goal, right? And so that was the first instant that my mindset started to sort of be changed about who could do, you know, really talented work in STEM, was to be around a really diverse group of people who really valued ideas that you brought to the table and could care less about your credentials, right? It was who has a good idea. And so at that table, I was equal to Lonnie in the sense that if I had an idea, it got just as much weight as it did coming from anyone on his team. Claudia Alexander, she also worked at JPL. She was got her PhD in like space physics from Michigan. She was amazing. So she was assigned to me as a mentor. And so I didn't do research with her, but she would like take me out every now and then. She took me to get my hair done. And, you know, we'd talk about boys, you know, or the lack thereof in my life. And she was just gorgeous. Like I would just drool over like, "Oh my gosh, Claudia, you're so beautiful. You're so smart," you know. And I just wanted to be her. You know, she was like, "You can do more than," I was like, "I can't do more than you. You got a PhD, you work at NASA, you're a rocket scientist," you know. And so she was just such a great mentor to me those 3 summers because she really gave me a visual of who and what I could become. You know, Spelman was great, Dr. Faulkner was great. She was a little older. And so, you know, I sort of saw her more as a grandmother. Claudia, I was like, "You're like the big sister I never had," right? And so I really wanted to become her. And really coveted that mentorship, that example that she provided me, especially as things got tough in grad school. So I graduated from Rice, finished my PhD there, and then looked for faculty positions, ended up on the faculty at Harvey Mudd College, one of the Claremont colleges out in Southern California. Here's a picture of our department. And one thing that I love about this picture is the diversity that you immediately see in it. There's a lot of diversity there that you don't see. You know, homosexual, heterosexual, gay, straight, atheist, agnostic, Jewish, Catholic, Christian. The whole gamut is in that picture. And the other thing I love about it is when our students see that picture, it says that this is the form that we think mathematical talent resides in, right? It's a subconscious image, right? Because as soon as I look at that picture, subconsciously my mind goes to who looks like me. Well, who's the woman? Oh, okay. Well, who's the African-American? Oh, okay, right? And so subconsciously, that's what our students think too when they see this picture and they see that they can find themselves, you know, whether by physical appearance or by gender orientation or by religious orientation, whatever it is, you can sort of find yourself in this picture. It lets them know that they're welcome in the mathematics community, right? Just one way of doing that. And so that's what I love about being in this particular department at this particular time in history, because our department talks about those and we're very intentional. Even in our hiring, how can we hire someone who's different from all of us, who brings something to the table, right? So today's conversation, three things we're gonna talk about. First, the achievement gap, America's achievement gap. Secondly, we'll talk about how to encourage a math mindset. So how do we begin to change the achievement gap in America, reduce that gap? And then how do we create some educational partnerships that are gonna help to promote STEM, and now that's STEAM, if you've seen STEM with the arts included. And we'll have a conversation, then we'll open the discussion for questions. All right, so first question, what is the achievement gap? By definition, this is just any persistent disparity between groups of students or unequal distribution of educational results. So likely all of us have seen achievement gaps within the environment that we work in, right, between different groups of students. And closing that gap is one of the challenges that faces our educational system, right? Whether it's research universities, liberal arts colleges, community colleges, all of us face issues with closing this achievement gap because it relates to this concept of fairness, of equity in education, right? How can we make sure that our educational environment is equitable to every student that participates in it? All right, pop quiz, this is your turn. Speak up. What are some of the most commonly discussed achievement gaps in the U.S.? Commonly discussed. All right, so just raise your hand or yell out. Yes, ma'am. Between? Yes. That's the question. Okay, so. Don't give them all. She's like, let me tell you, I know. There's race, there's gender. Yeah. Yeah, all right, so. Stop right there, otherwise you
I'm
will.
I'm tweeting, I'm not on Facebook. Look, I'm tweeting about you.
We should do a selfie and then tweet that out.
Okay. Let's totally do that. All right, we're totally gonna do this.
Sorry, talk amongst yourselves.
We'll give you a topic.
Awesome, send that out. Yeah, you're so welcome. Okay. All right, so we got race and gender. What else? Where else do you see achievement gaps? English proficiency, yes, I'm coming to the back to make sure you're awake. What else? Socioeconomic. The further I come, the more the comments get to, you're like, don't come talk to us. You said remedial education, was that right? Awesome. What else? Technology, right? Students that have greater access to technology versus those that don't. What else? Rural versus urban, great. Other areas? What about when you think about international students versus American students? Okay. Learning disabilities, right? Learning disabilities versus those without. Learning disabilities, these are great. All right, so here are some of the ones you said. And a few others, students from higher income versus lower income households, students whose parents have had a college degree versus those who are first generation, okay? So all these different groups you can often see achievement gaps in. What causes the achievement gap? Back at you. Lack of funding, what do you think? What do you think the number one cause is?
Bias.
Bias, I like that, bias. What else? Access. poverty, mindset. Title of the talk today, what's it? Stereotype threat, yep. What else? What do you think leads to the achievement gap? Students' own perception, like of their ability to be successful, absolutely. What else? Lack of education, right? Do you mean access, parents' education, students' education, lack of it in general, okay? What else comes to mind when you think about what might cause the achievement gap in our country? Money. Right?
Parental engagement.
Educational politics and legislation. How often have you heard this talked about in our current presidential race? How often have we focused on the conversation around education? Not much. Unfortunately, right? From either party. Poverty, you were right. Number one, income inequality is the most highly correlated with the educational gap. Cuts across race, cuts across gender. Poverty is the number one correlator. In addition to that, you mentioned most all of these, stereotype threat, bias, institutionalized predispositions, teaching or ineffective teaching, right? You have a disproportionate number of minority students who are in lower performing schools, right? So urban versus rural institutions, right? Parental factors, low educational attainment among parents can often lead to that. You said all of these, English language understanding, and then also flawed testing and assessment designs. Not the most encouraging way to start your morning, but it's the reality, right? So as the statistician in me is always interested in presenting the data, like what do the facts show about this so that we can then begin to address the problem, right? Because if we don't understand the root cause, then it's hard to think of a solution when we haven't really accurately examined what the issues are. We talked about these socioeconomic factors like poverty. 18.7 million children live in poverty, which is defined as a family of four with an income less than $23,550 per year. Because we all know that if you make $25,000 with a family of four, you are good to go, really. Like you're straight. But if you're at $23,550, then yeah, it might be harder for you, okay? So even this number is, you know, I mean, how far could you? You could probably go up to 30, 32, 35, and still have families that are in poverty. That breaks down to 5.3 million white children, 4.2 million black children, and 5.9 million Hispanic children. And that's just by this definition of poverty, right? Which has some flaw in it, in and of itself. So then these children are growing up in an environment where they're the ones who are most likely to be on the bottom end of the gap, right? Other factors that we'll get to as soon as the clicker moves us forward. Oh, restart your computer to finish installing important updates. Why don't we postpone that? All right. This is not my laptop, by the way. I just want to put that out there. Awesome. All right. Here's your third question of the morning. As of 2008, I'm glad it didn't automatically restart. That would have been not a great thing. As of 2008, I want you to tell me what percentage of white Americans between the ages of 25 and 34 do you think had at least an associate's degree? What percentage white Americans 25 to 34 as of 2008 had at least an associate's degree? 20%. Closer to 40.
let me Google it real quick. As of 2008, what percentage? Hey, Siri, as of 2008, what percentage?
What do you think? 60%. You think a lot of white people. I love that. Yes, 60%.
Don't be offended by that. That was really good. Right.
So we got 20%, 40%, 60%. Who's got 80? I need more numbers because none of those are correct. So 30? 2%. 2%. Well, I mean, you know. So the numbers are sort of forcing you to engage and think about it and then commit, right? Because I could just tell you and then you'd be like, eh. But to ask you to think about it forces you to then come up with a number, right? And justify why you came up with that, even if you just do that mentally, right? So that's why I'm pulling numbers out of you. I see numbers all day, every day. 38%, between 30 and 40. So those first clues, yeah, take the average out a little bit. You were close. What percentage of African Americans between 25 and 34? 15. 25. 10. 38. 50. 26% of African Americans, and the largest growing group in our society, had 18%. So there's a lot of room for education in our country, and that's not going to look traditional, right? Everybody's not going to pay $40,000 to come to my campus for 4 years to leave with a degree, right? So what you do is critical. As of 2010, 36% of women between 25 and 29 held a bachelor's degree or better versus only 28% of men in the same group. I don't make the data up, I guess. Women are smarter. All right, you may even see some of this maybe in some of your courses, especially in your online courses. Do you observe more women? And maybe that's relative to field too, right? You might not see those women in some of your STEM courses if you offer those, okay? Other more subtle factors are things like peer pressure. You know, when I was growing up, if you were a really smart black kid, what did you get called? Nerd, white, Oreo. Who knew that? I'd get that all the time. I guess we would get that all the time, right? You're a smart black kid, you're an Oreo. You're black on the outside, but you must be white on the inside. My office mate in grad school, Julie, said she would get called a banana. She was Asian, and she was smart, and their word was a banana for her, right? And so when we think about sometimes what pushes students out of particular areas, it could be this peer pressure that you don't even see. I don't even see that, right? That happens on the playground, or that happens in the cafeteria if you're in high school. Why are you in that AP course? Nobody's taking that, right? And so then students come into your environment with this baggage because they haven't had the support. Student tracking. In high school, you can get tracked. You can be on a college track or not, right? And oftentimes, students who are strong in different areas get tracked in their lowest, in their weakest area, and can't break out of that, right? If you're not set up from your first freshman year to take calculus by the time you graduate, you're not going to be able to take it. It's not like you can sort of jump ahead, right? Negative stereotyping, test bias, you all mentioned this. So these are other factors that lead to the achievement gap that you see in your students. There was a study 4 years ago, Generation STEM, what women say, what girls say about science and technology, engineering, and mathematics. This particularly appealed to me because at Harvey Mudd College, you know, initially 15 years ago, we were heavily male, very little diversity. And so when I came, I said, I don't see women in my classes, and where are the women who look like me? I really didn't see them. And so I wanted to know, as a faculty member, what could I do to try to get more girls excited about STEM? So here's what this study said. Teenage girls often don't feel welcome in STEM classrooms. They don't see the connection between what they're learning and what they want to pursue, and they don't have role models. And so I thought if I wanted to do something to address the achievement gap between, say, women and men in STEM, underrepresented groups in STEM, I would first need to sort of address these big themes, right? Help people feel welcome in a STEM environment, give them an example of who they could become, and then help them see the connection of STEM to something that they're excited about. So let's talk about then how do we cultivate a STEM mindset? And I think everyone can do this, even if you don't necessarily think you have a STEM mindset, we can all help to cultivate one. Why is that important? Because we're bringing up the next generation. So even if I'm not excited about math, like I don't need to pass that on to my sons. When they come to me with a math problem, I'm like, oh, your mom can't do that. Son, you're not gonna need to know that. Just, right? So we pass a STEM mindset or not onto our kids. So it's important that we all have a STEM mindset just so that we can, you know, get the next generation really excited about it. And also I think we'd be surprised to see the talent that we have in and of ourselves. So let's talk about developing mindset. How many of you have heard of Carol Dweck's work on mindset? She has an amazing TED Talk. Watch it after you watch mine again on a separate device. On mindset, she talks about having a growth mindset versus a fixed mindset. She's a psychologist at Stanford. She says, in a fixed mindset, people believe their basic qualities like their intelligence or talent are simply fixed traits. They spend their time documenting their intelligence or talent instead of developing them. They also believe that talent alone creates success without effort. How many of you are sitting next to someone with a fixed mindset? Raise your hand high. Just raise it. Raise it high. Jerry Rice looking at their neighbor like, no, no, not them, not them. To contrast, she says, in a growth mindset, people believe their most basic abilities can be developed through dedication and hard work. Brains and talents are just a starting point. This view creates a love of learning and a resilience that is essential for great accomplishment. Virtually all great people have these qualities. Now raise your hand. Are you next to someone with a growth mindset? Right? Most of us are. Right? Because you wouldn't be in this room if you didn't have a growth mindset. What do they look like side by side? So with a fixed mindset, people believe your intelligence is static. You're born with it. You know, I'm just not a math person. I just wasn't born with that math gene. It skipped a generation or four, right? That's a fixed mindset. It causes you to avoid challenges, give up easily due to obstacles, ignore useful feedback, be threatened by others' success. Compared to a growth mindset, you believe that intelligence can be developed. This leads you to do things like persist despite obstacles, embrace challenges, see effort as a path to mastery, be inspired by other people's success. So I argue that in learning mathematics, even in junior high and high school, in learning mathematics, you were forced into a growth mindset. Because nobody got every problem right all the time, right? You always got critical feedback. It was clear if you got something right or wrong. I get an English paper back with a B+. I guess that's good. What could I improve? I could write better. You know, is there a word I could change out that would have made it an A-? Right? Math, this is wrong because your solution is incorrect. Great, critical feedback. I can take that and I can do it until I get it right. I would rewrite papers and they just wouldn't get any better. And I was like, I don't understand. Did my subject verb not agree? It was just harder, for me at least, right, to embrace that. Be inspired by others' success. Do you know how excited we would get when one person got the problem right? Be like, oh my, did you get that problem? Did you get number 6? How do you do it? Oh, good. Okay, no, okay, great. That's where I got stuck. Right? So the process of learning mathematics forces you to have a growth mindset because you can't do it independently. You can't do it alone. You're always going to get critical feedback. You're going to get something wrong. And if you're going to be successful in it, you have to persist. You have to work in teams. You have to work with other people, right, to get better and better at it. So the discipline itself trains you to have this growth mindset. Carol actually gives examples. But before I show her examples, let me make sure our computer doesn't restart again because the clicker has turned off. Why don't you, let's see, remind me in 4 hours, how about that? Okay, postpone. There we go, all right. Here's what she says, how to encourage students. I'm gonna admit to you, even though it's being recorded, so it will go on internet perpetuity, I used to say this, not everybody's good in math, baby, just do your best, it's okay. It's okay. Math just might not be one of your strengths. I'd say that thinking that I was helping my students, right? Thinking I'm saying something that's gonna encourage them and make them comfortable. And what I was really doing was encouraging them to have a fixed mindset, right? I wasn't inviting them to the table. I was saying, oh, it's okay if you're not at the table. You can just sit over there with the sociologist. They've got room. Right? I mean, that's what we do in STEM, right? Either, you know, if you don't have it, it's okay. It's some psychologists out there, some historians that will take you in and they'll work with you wherever you are. But when you come here, you need to know it. Right? I work with these people, I know, I hear them. When they complain about students that come to them, how they're so not prepared, but then to say, hey, well, what, maybe you should change how you teach. Oh, this is how I've taught it for 30 years. It's the students' fault. Those high schools just don't prepare them to take my material. Right? Here's what she says we should say. When you learn how to do a new kind of problem, it grows your math brain, right? If you catch yourself saying, I'm not a math person, just add the word yet at the end of that sentence. I'm not a math person yet. Because subconsciously, when you say yet, your mind says, okay, then how do we get there? Right? Because we're on our way there, we just haven't gotten there yet, right? I say that every morning, I'm not at 135 pounds. Yet, just to let my body know this is, we're gonna get there. One day, might be 75, but I'm gonna get to 135, right? She gives other examples. She says that feeling of math being hard is the feeling of your brain growing, right? The point isn't to get it right away. The point is to grow your understanding step by step. What can you try next? This is inviting students to the table, recognizing that you're gonna struggle with this, that this is challenging, and that's okay, because I'm here to shepherd you through that process, which is not how we uniformly teach mathematics or STEM at all in this country. Right, it's let's see who survives the first semester. Let's see who survives the weed out courses. Why do we call them weed out? English doesn't have weed out courses. Right, anthropology, couldn't cut it. Weeded me out. Right, but everybody knows engineering, weed out courses. Oh, couldn't get past the math. I got, hey, and we accept that, and that's not okay. Hard work beats out talent when talent fails to work hard. All right, so give me a hardworking student that doesn't believe they can do math any day over a talented kid that doesn't want to work in my class. Because I can't do anything with talent that doesn't want to work, right? I can take a hardworking person and get them excited about math any day, right? We can go back to 2 + 2 if that's where we need to, but we can get up to differential equations, right, with a can-do attitude. Secondly, then, how do you cultivate a STEM mindset? You have to create high expectations with support. Right, we do our students a disservice when we don't give them high expectations, when we tell them it's okay to stay in your mediocrity, right? I want you to read through these. I want you to find the one that resonates the most with you, and then tell me what it is and why you chose that one. Which one of these do you wish you had heard? Or which one of these do you think would be most powerful in implementing? And I'm gonna start at the back of the room, just give you a heads up. I'm back there. I'm gonna just start calling you out in the back. So get to the bottom of that list quickly. Like, I can't see. You could. All right, back here, let's see. What'd you like? Second from the bottom. As you learn this, mistakes are expected. Your mistakes help me support you. Let's make mistakes together. That's a good one, because it changes the way students come into the classroom, that this is a place to make mistakes. Like, I'm here to make a mistake. And as an instructor, when I see a mistake, I see where the weakness is, right? I can address that. If you don't make a mistake, then how am I to, you know, I feel like I know you must be getting everything so I can go faster, right? What else resonates with you here? You're gonna remember this the rest of your life, right? It might be difficult right now, but you're gonna remember it for the rest of your life. I'm here to help you meet the goal. Yep. That's right. It's okay that it's hard, and it's okay that it's challenging, and you're going to feel so good when you get it. Yeah. Everything doesn't have to be easy or come easy or come natural. What else resonates with you? Yeah. Yep. That's right. That's right. It's challenging, but all of us can reach the goal. Not all of you, because I've already gotten there. I've got my PhD check. Right? All of us can get there. It's going to be challenging for all of us, and we can get there. That's right. I like that you'll remember it for the rest of your life. You know what I remember that was tough for me to learn as a high school senior? Was tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the path to dusty death. Out, brief candle. Life is but a walking shadow, a poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage and is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing. For Macbeth. Right? Because my teacher made me learn it. You got to get up and recite it. And I was like, well, I don't memorize. Can I do an equation on the board? Right? But I've never forgotten that. And that's the only thing I know from Macbeth, because I had to learn it and it was hard for me. And so I made myself learn it. Right? I made myself repeat it over and over until now I can say it. I forget my kids' names, but I can say Macbeth. Look, tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow. The three of you, let's go. Right? Like, that's what I remember. Clifford Adelman worked at the U.S. Department of Education. He did a study of the correlation between the high school courses that students took and their college completion, whether they completed college with any degree in any area. He found that of all the pre-college curriculum, the highest level of math that one studied in secondary school had the strongest continuing influence on bachelor's degree completion. The highest level of math you took in high school was the highest correlated with whether or not you graduated from college in any area. Here's what he found. 46.4% of students that had Algebra 2 as their highest level of math went on to complete a bachelor's degree in any subject. 64.7% of students that had trigonometry, almost 76% of students that had pre-calculus, 82% of students that had calculus went on to complete bachelor's degrees. Not necessarily in STEM, in anything. Why do you think that is? I think part of the reason is that growth mindset. Right? By the time you get to calculus, you've got that growth mindset. And so you go into college with that same mindset, right? Versus students that may not have had time to master that growth mindset. So success in mathematics inherently cultivates a growth mindset, right? And we can talk later, okay, now what do we do about kids who haven't been successful? How do we then get them there? We can talk about that later. One thing we can do is create supportive educational communities, cultivate this STEM mindset early. And so that's what I did at Harvey Mudd. I reached out to local organizations because I wanted to somehow bring girls in at the age where we could tell them that, where we could start to foster a growth mindset before it got too late and get them excited about math and science and engineering. So I went to our local high school, Claremont High School in Claremont, California. It's a well-resourced school. You know, the city of Claremont is very well-resourced. And so the guidance counselors here, I worked with them to take the information that they share with their students, you know, many of whom are kids of college professors of the Claremont Colleges, and share it with girls from all over, from LA County, San Bernardino County, from schools that didn't have as much access, schools that might have had one guidance counselor in the entire school. I mean, they have a guidance team. And some of my girls came from places that had a counselor, who more so dealt with mental issues than getting kids to college, right? So I partnered with them, talked to local churches, fraternities, sororities, just to try to get kids on campus, get girls on campus so that we could create this experience for them. Nikki Mitchell, who's up here in the back with a purple shirt on, she actually came and did a workshop for the parents. Somebody mentioned getting parents involved. We learned that the first year when we brought girls from 12 to 18 to campus and the parents sat around. They're like, I'm not leaving my baby girl on this college campus. I will be here the whole day. And so we were like, so what do we do with all these parents who were here that we didn't expect? And so then we started, we had this impromptu discussion and they talked about some challenges that they face at their daughter's school. They talked about not having resources. And so then we started to put a parent component together as part of the conference. So parents would come, bring their daughters, and then they'd have a whole special session. Nikki and other speakers, and we give them resources. So they'd leave, and then we also created communities because, you know, oftentimes parents didn't know what other parents in their district or their school were really excited about trying to get their daughters into STEM. And so then they were able to make connections and create a community among the parents. So it was really beautiful, but it started in an ad hoc way that first year when parents just sort of sat around. So every year we've had them. I worked intensively with folks on our campus. This is really was really new to me because as a faculty member, we didn't really go to the other side of campus where the administrators were. It's kind of like, all right, I do my teaching, I do my research, and then somehow they bring in a class, they make that stuff happen, you know? Some of you may be some of those administrators that get treated like that by faculty. And so when I you know, had sort of this idea, I was like, well, I don't know. I think we've got people who can, like, help me, and let me go talk to them. So I went over to our Office of Communications and Marketing, met with Judy and Stephanie, and I said, hey, I want to do this sort of one-day event where I bring people to campus. Can you help me? And they're like, yeah, we can do a website. We can get you a photographer. You know, you'll need food. You'll need to reserve rooms. And I was like, yes, yes, all of that, all of that. Like, who knew they had, you know, they knew how to run this. And I had no money, no budget, you know, I just had like a dream and a vision. I have a dream that one day students will gather here and we will learn and cultivate a STEM mindset. And so they sort of started to add some scaffolding to that idea. And then they said, you should go ask the Office of Institutional Advancement. Any of you familiar work in advancement? Go ask them for money. And I was like, don't they bring in? It's okay, I'm over here, I'm on this side of the campus, may as well walk next door. So I walked over, met with Dan Macaluso, DMAC, our VP of Institutional Advancement, said, Dan, I got this great idea. Let me tell you, I want to bring these girls and their parents and do something fun. And what do you think about it? Because this was new to me, right, talking to staff about an idea that I had about education, you know. And he's like, great, you know, we've got some potential trustees and donors that are interested in access, and it would be great if they could come to your event so they could see what we're doing. And we've got alums that have been wanting to connect because our alums are all math, science, engineering. And so they want to give back. They want a way to give back locally, and I'm sure they'd love to be engaged. I was like, this is awesome. You know, if I could just feed them when they come, that's all I need to do. If you could just help me feed them, it might be a better experience for the donors. I don't know. You tell me, you know? And so he's like, yeah, we can help you feed them. I was like, yeah, just breakfast, lunch, maybe a little coffee break, whatever, whatever. And so they did. So they footed the bill, covered all the food for the parents, for the kids. We also have an Office of Community Engagement. Gabriella had contact information for high school counselors. So I reached out to her and just said, this is our event. Can you send this out and have them invite every underrepresented girl from their school to our campus on this date with her parents? And she's like, yeah, I can totally do that. And I can come work the event and I can print out signs for you. And I was like, signs? Just never occurred to me that I would need signs to help people like get from parking to the auditorium. And my mind's like, you parking, you walk to the auditorium, how hard does that be? She's like, well, some of these people have never been on a college campus. I was like, oh. Right, things that I take for granted, that a lot of these girls had never walked on the Claremont College's campus and never thought they would ever walk on it. Right, so the part of our conference that doesn't come out in the programming is getting people used to just being in this environment and being comfortable in this environment, right, and beginning to see themselves there. So Gabriella showed up, she worked the event, she helped me partner with local organizations. We've gotten some national publicity. Forbes magazine featured our conference, how we go about increasing educational opportunities for minorities in STEM. They highlighted the work that we do in reaching girls, bringing them to a day-long conference, usually around 150 African-American and Hispanic girls that come to our campus for the day. And then local news media, Inland Valley News, the Daily Bulletin. Each year, they usually write up a summary and sort of advertise for free for us. This really connects people in the community to our institution in a way that I hadn't really imagined would happen. I remember being in a grocery store with a Harvey Mutt t-shirt on, and they were like, you guys do that program for the girls. I was like, we do a program. You know, on a Saturday, you bring them to campus, and I was like, yes, we sure do that program for the girls. But people in the community were starting to be proud that they were close to a school that was really trying to change the landscape, you know, for women and underrepresented groups in STEM. So that was sort of a nice side effect. We got featured. We're currently doing a capital campaign, and we got featured. You see that? I call that featured. That is totally featured. We're in the book. That means the money that comes in, some of it gets to go to us. I think that's. But we got featured in the Capital campaign. And so to me, what this says is the college is owning this as this is an event that we do. This is what we're committed to doing. These are the types of ideas that we want to support. Right? This is the type of contribution we want to have on society. Most of these girls are not going to come to Harvey Mudd. Not because we don't want them to, but they're interested in lots of other things. But I want them to know that they can be good at STEM if they choose to. And even if they choose not to, it's not because they couldn't do it. Right? It's because they chose not to do it, right? If you go to our website, you see where the conference is highlighted. This is what the communications office put all of this together. It's tons of other things. You'll see articles. But our institution is owning this. It's not just Talithia's pet project. She does that little thing. It's this is what we do, right? We've done it for 5 years in a row. So, each year we bring girls to our campus. Here are just two pictures from our Science and Technology Conference for Underrepresented Girls. Part of the event is threefold. So up top you see Melissa. Melissa's an HMC grad who comes back every year to do a session on the work that she does, or how she uses STEM in her current job. So each year we have workshops that are done by women of color, who talk about how they use math and science in their work. We also, at the bottom, provide little small roundtable discussions. So we'll put a female mentor at a table for them to just ask random questions, whatever questions they want to ask, but to get to know on a really personal basis. And then we also create some of it where we give them a microphone. So there's a question that each girl has to answer, right? And so that just helps her claim her space, own that space, say something in that space, right? And this is really modeled after my experience with Claudia, because I felt like she gave me all of that. She gave me that personal attention. She allowed me to be in her space. You know, and she was an excellent example of a scientist for me. And so in 2015, who would have thought to actually invite Claudia to be a keynote? I didn't think of it for 5 years. And she was just still down the street at JPL. I was like, wait a minute. We should totally ask Claudia. This conference is built
after my interaction with her, you know, 20 years ago, and it never occurred to me to invite her to the conference that she inspired. And so April 25th, 2015, we actually had her come out and speak. She was amazing. You see, this picture was taken from the back, but the auditorium was full. I probably took up more time introducing her than she took speaking, because I was just like, you guys don't understand. Claudia Alexander is the reason. I mean, it was just, you know, this emotional moment, and, you know. This is really special for me for two reasons. One, because it almost felt like the baton was being passed, right? It was just to see, for her to see what she had inspired in me, and for her to see that together we were inspiring this next generation of girls, was transformational. The other reason it was transformational was because exactly 2.5 months later, she passed away. 2.5 months. And I remember when I saw this, when I saw the news, I was like, no, she can't. No, she was just here. I just reconnected with her. And to be honest, as a person of faith, this really shook me. You know, I was like, God, I know you don't make mistakes, but you've made your first one. This was it. You know, 56 years old, breast cancer. Still working at NASA. She was project scientist for the European Space Center. Worked on the Galileo mission. She was the lead scientist for Galileo, passed away. And so her death made me ask myself a question, and that was, what legacy am I gonna leave behind? You know, it's great to bring these girls to campus, it's great to get them excited, but ultimately, what's gonna be my legacy? What's gonna be your legacy? How do you wanna impact the people that are around you and the people that are coming behind you? And I think there's power in one. We can be the difference in our institution. We can be the difference in our field. And we have to push that change. And I think Claudia was that example for me, and I'm hoping to be that example to you today. Thank you so much. All right, so I'm happy to take questions. There's two microphones here in the middle. I think we've got about 10 minutes for questions. And if you don't have questions, I have more stories. I'll just ad lib and for 10 minutes. So come on up. Andy. Oh, can you introduce yourself and tell us where you're from, and then
and blow into the microphone? I'm Andy Fisher. I'm from Lesley University in Cambridge, Massachusetts. You mentioned STEAM at the beginning. Mm-hmm. How? What's your opinion on the addition of the A to STEM? Has it helped the STEM movement? Has it detracted? What's your opinion?
I think it's critical. I think it's helped. I think more institutions need to adopt a STEAM model. At Harvey Mudd, we only have six majors: math, physics, chemistry, biology, engineering, and computer science. Y'all are like, what? But each student has to have a humanities concentration. Otherwise, quite honestly, they wouldn't be well-rounded individuals. And so I think it's critical that our students are well-versed in the humanities, that they have an area that they're particular experts in. And I regret seeing students that only focus solely on whatever their STEM area is. Yeah, yeah. Awesome, other questions? Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Trace Erden. I'm a research analyst at Credit Suisse. My question was, have you had any contact with the admissions people at the Claremont colleges about what they're doing to reach out to these underrepresented communities?
Yeah, so most of my contact is with folks at Harvey Mudd, just because I'm not connected to the admissions departments and those other institutions. I was literally emailing folks from our admissions office yesterday. I got an email from a classmate of mine from Spelman whose daughter is thinking about Harvey Mudd. And here's what she said. She said, we were looking at the website. We saw what your retention rate was for African Americans. It was dismal. It was like 66%.
50%, 60%. And, you know, my daughter likes your institution, but she's concerned about the success there. And I mean, just quite honest, right? I replied back, I CC'd the admissions director, CC'd the other counselor that I knew. I said, these are great questions. Let me tell you why it is and how it's changing. You know, before when we had three African-American students and one of them didn't make it to their sophomore year, you're right, we had a 60% retention rate among African-American students because we went from 3 to 2. Losing one person is horrible, but going from like 100 to 60 would be, you know, worse. So part of that issue was that our numbers were so small that as soon as you lost a person, you lost 20%, you know. Our admissions department and has worked close with faculty to bring in a diverse group of students. So 3 years ago, HMC faculty called and emailed every non-white, non-Asian student that got accepted. I mean, you would have thought we were recruiting for a football team. I was like, hey, this is Prof. Williams, how are you? Hey, I heard you got in the Harvey Mudd, awesome! Do you want to be in my section in the fall? Like, what? Let me know. In fact, are you coming to, you know, this day? We want to welcome you to campus, we can have lunch. And so parents were like, you need to go to that Harvey Mudd place, some professor call. Right? So we literally recruited students and got them excited about coming to our campus because we said, we really value them. Here's the courses that we are gonna teach and I'd love for you to be in my class, right? So we tripled our yield that year when faculty partnered and really were intentional in reaching out. But it's not just enough to bring students in, right? Like, great, you're here, nice, good to see you, thanks for coming. All right, so then we had to be really intentional in how we support all of our students, because these students also got into Caltech and MIT, so if they weren't successful, it wasn't because they weren't talented, right? It was other reasons. So we had to really come to terms with understanding, what do we need to do to help all students be successful? Because it's not just that they leave because they couldn't do it, it's something in our environment that's forcing them to leave and transfer to Caltech or somewhere else, right? So getting faculty to embrace the idea that when you've got students in your class, they're all talented. They got in here, they're amazing. You know, what is it about you or what is it that we can do to make our environment better? And then the last thing I'll say is being honest with the data. You know, I mean, it hurt me to have to send that email, but it was good at the end to say, you know, we've more than tripled the number of African-American students in our entering class. In fact, the past 3 years, we've had 10%. And part of that is getting a critical mass. That first year we got students, they helped to recruit the next year of students. And then all of a sudden we have like 25 black students on a campus of, you know, 830 people. And then all of a sudden we got to 75. And so now you walk around, and what's exciting for me is when I see a black student whose name I don't know. Because before I could name all six of them. And now I'm like, oh my, you're a student here? I don't even know who you are. Oh my gosh, it's so good to see you. Because I have no idea. I haven't had you in my class. You're a junior and I haven't had you in my class yet. And I don't even know your name. That's such a great feeling for me to have a student of color who I don't know yet. Because before it was just, I mean, I'd have them over to my house and they'd fit at the table and there'd be two seats left. You know? So I think it's critical to have faculty and staff working together if you're gonna change the culture of an institution. It's not just on the admissions to bring in talented students. It's gotta have support all around. Yeah, that's an excellent question, thank you. Other questions? Sure. You don't, you can just yell, I'll repeat it.
So, you have 5 years of seeing these young women. What does your data tell you in terms of what
That's excellent. So here's what we don't have necessarily is we don't keep track of them beyond sort of their regular attendance. So for instance, girls who've been to our program who graduate and go off to college or do whatever, we have no way of tracking them, primarily because I don't have the manpower, right? So it's just sort of a one-woman show for this one big day. And even though I have email addresses, those change and I'm not, you know, like, hey, by the way, update this website. So, you know, I think if we had more funding, we would hire someone to be collecting this data, reaching out to people. How did this conference affect you? You know, how have you grown? Did it inspire you? Anecdotally, every year that, you know, folks have to go on and register, we do ask them, had they come in previous years? So we do have some data of girls that come back year to year or parents who sort of anecdote, you know, we do surveys and they say, oh my gosh, this inspired my daughter. She decided to take these classes instead of so-and-so. And so we have anecdotal data, but nothing that's really deep that I could do like a statistical analysis of to see, you know, does this program make a difference? In my own experience, you know, when I think about my interaction with Claudia, it wasn't a magical moment. It was literally having her as an example. I would think about that in grad school. When I was struggling and I wanted to quit, the 13 times I was ready to quit, I'd be like, well, Claudia did it. Okay, I guess I'll tough it out. I'll tough this one out. And so just having that visual and that vision helped sustain me. Even when I wasn't reaching out to her and emailing her and saying, I've got this question, I'm stuck here, it was really just knowing that someone before me had done it and been successful. Yes, ma'am. We don't, no. The parents have sort of a parental group that lasts as long as their kid is in high school, right? As soon as your kid graduates, you're sort of then focused on their college experience. The girls, not necessarily. The ages range from 12 to 18. Lots of girls are on social media, but some aren't. Some parents don't allow that. And so I've just been really hesitant about what I put out there as, you know, join this, you know, thing to folks who are underage. So we have to get them to sort of sign off and get approval for a lot of that. Part of it is also maintaining it, right? So it wouldn't be something I could engage in on a regular basis to, I think, make it really meaningful. But that's a great question. Yeah. We've got time for one more question. Yes. Ooh, that's a great question. A couple of things. So when you look at some of the research that suggests, you know, how women and underrepresented groups are successful in an online environment, some of it talks about creating a virtual classroom with diverse students and a diverse instructor, right? So one study showed that women in particular did better when they thought there were more women in the classroom. Or if you sort of gave people virtual images that were very diverse, African Americans did better because they felt like, oh, I'm not the only black kid in this classroom, even though you maybe could be. But I can generate a class that sort of matches your profile, not completely, but you know what I mean, sort of randomly, but also sort of how do you create a diverse environment to help students be successful? And so they saw that women who, in particular, took a computer science course where they thought there were more women in the classroom did better than those who took a CS course where there were only a couple women in the classroom. So I think there are ways in an online environment to configure a setting, right? Maybe your tutor, if it's a virtual tutor, maybe the tutor has a female name, right? So ways to sort of help people feel like they're in that environment, they're welcome in that environment, and they can be successful. Thank you. Thank you guys so much. This was wonderful. Thank you. Thanks, Todd.
That was wonderful.
Awesome. Yeah. It was fun.
Got a little something for you back here. That was so inspirational, really. Be the difference. I like that. So this is, as you know, a scene from the Kentucky
no
Derby.
Way. So, oh, so you nice.
Hang this up in your office or...
I'm
Thank
totally
so
going
to
tweet that out. Oh, awesome.
Yeah. Well, we're so happy you came Thanks. All the way out here
oh,
to be with us.
I wouldn't miss it.
So inspirational, really. Be
Thank
the
you.
Difference. I like that.
Thanks,
it's a good
Todd.
One.
Thanks you know? So much.
All right. Great.